The innovation of Carl Fischer reagent has made the determination of water content very easy. You will find hardly any lab without the KF autotitrator. And that is the success of this one reagent. So in this video, we are going to talk about a little bit history of the evaluation of the KF reagent. Then what is the working principles of the KF reagent, and then what are the side reactions which are possible, and because of that one can end up with the false positive or the false negative result. So let us begin with the presentation now, and here we go with the first point, that is the history and the principle of the KF reagent. So if you have to understand the history of the KF reagent, then you need to go back in the time when the Bunsen reaction was widely used for determination of sulfur dioxide present into the aqueous solutions. So would you like to know what is the reaction mechanisms by which free sulfur dioxide was evaluated into the aqueous solutions? And have a look at the reaction over here. So there is iodine present into it, then the sulfur dioxide and the water molecule ends up with hydroiodic acid plus sulfuric acid. Now this is the reaction the Bunsen has used for determination of sulfur dioxide. So the Carl Fischer, the innovator of the Carl Fischer reagent, has thought over that can this reaction mechanism be used for estimation of the water content present into a given sample, and he has used this very effectively. Once you understand that this one equation reaction mechanism or the Bunsen reaction mechanism can be used for determination of water content if there is a sulfur dioxide present available in the excess, so that the available sulfur dioxide will be utilized to determine the water content present into a sample. And the acid so produced in the reaction, if it gets neutralized by the suitable base. So if you look at the reaction mechanism, you will find sulfuric acid at the end. So excess sulfuric acid, the excess sulfur dioxide and the based to neutralize the acid generated are the two important requirements Carl Fischer felt to enable to use this reaction mechanism for determination of the water content. Then the Carl Fischer has used pyridine as the base molecule to neutralize the acid generated. And then the classic reagent is born. The solution of sulfur dioxide and iodine in a mixture of pyridine and the methanol. So these four constituents creates the reagent which is popularly known as the KF reagent. And I'm sure you must have used this KF reagent into your day-to-day activities. So what is the early formulation of the KF reagent looks like? So the 254 gram of iodine is dissolved into 5 liters of methanol, and then this further treated with 790 gram of pyridine and then 192 gram of liquid sulfur dioxide. But the problem with this combination of the reagent was not much stable. That we call as the titer value or the factor, the Carl Fischer reagent factor. So the factor is to change very drastically over a period of time. And then the second version of the reagent got prepared by mixing 30 gram iodine in 1 liter of methanol, and then this further treated with 300 ml pyridine and 60 gram of sulfur dioxide, and this has resulted into the stable Carl Fischer reagent. So I just try to make you clear from where the Carl Fischer reagent got developed and what is the the backbone of this one idea of creating a reagent which can be used for determination of the water. So later on, it is also found that the reagent stability can be increased by replacing methanol by ethylene glycol monomethyl ether. So this is just an additional information wherein one can understand how the stable reagent can be prepared. And then we know that the earlier reagents was coming with the pyridine as a base molecule, but later on the pyridine got replaced with the suitable base. And what is the reason for replacing the pyridine? Because of its noxious odor and toxicity. And that's the reason the pyridine later on got replaced. And during the replacement of the pyridine by suitable base, now these many bases were tried. The first one is diethanol amine, sodium acetate, sodium salicylate, and imidazole. So finally, you know that which have got the better success. And the imidazole is found to be more ideal as compared to other bases because of what? It's similar to pyridine and it is also odor free and has a higher basicity as compared to even pyridine. And that's made imidazole as the preferred base, which is not toxic and which doesn't have any odor. And that's the reason in nowadays we are getting the reagent which is pyridine free, made up of imidazole. So this is the history and how the Carl Fischer reagents got evolved in. Would you like to know the side reactions which are possible that further may lead to the false positive or the false negative results? Yes, and here are those side reactions now. And this could be the limitations of the Carl Fischer reagent. And one has to be very clear and vigilant while using the Carl Fischer reagent for determination of water content. And what are those side reactions? So side reactions are generally the limitations of Carl Fischer reagents, where the only water will not react with the Carl Fischer reagent, but something else present into a sample, maybe the particular functional groups may also get interact with the Carl Fischer reagent, and then you end up with the higher result or the lower result for the water content. So one has to be very vigilant and careful while selecting KF as a water determination technique. And here is the first point, that is carbonates, hydroxides and the oxides. So what may happen with the, if your sample consists of carbonates, hydroxide or and the oxides. So the hydroiodic acid produced during reaction interact with the carbonates, hydroxides and oxides and release water molecule. So what is going to happen over there? Because of the reaction with the hydroiodic acid, you actually get the additional water molecules. And if there is a increment or release of the water molecule, then further you will end up with the false positive result. And here is the reaction with the sodium carbonate with hydroiodic acid, and look at the screen over here that releases the water molecule. So if the substance under testing itself can release the water content, water molecule, will you be able to use KF reagent for determination of the water content? You will not. And this is the limitation of the KF reagent. The second is what? The oxides now, the magnesium oxide. Magnesium oxide reacts with the hydroiodic acid and then further releases water molecule. Third is what? The calcium hydroxide. The calcium hydroxide now interacts with the sulfuric acid. And you know what is the source of sulfuric acid? Because sulfuric acid also gets generated during the Carl Fischer reagent reaction. And this sulfuric acid can react with calcium hydroxide, and then again the calcium hydroxide can release the water molecules. And that's made these three, the KF reagents, unsuitable in case of carbonates, hydroxides and the oxides. So this is the first side reaction that we just discussed. The second is what? The aldehydes and the ketones. So the Carl Fischer reagent is also not suitable to analyze water content present into aldehydes and the ketones. So what happens in case of aldehydes and ketones? And here are the details. So the aldehydes or ketones combine with the methanol in the Carl Fischer reagent to form acetals and ketals respectively with the release of water. And would you like to see the reaction mechanism? Yes. And here is the details of the reaction. What happens? So the aldehydes form the acetal plus the water molecule when react with the methanol. And what is the source of methanol here? Because the Carl Fischer reagent contains methanol as a diluent. So this methanol reacts with aldehyde and ends up getting the water molecule. So let us further understand how the reaction mechanism goes. So with aldehydes, the reactivity decreases as the chain length increases. As the carbon chain increases of the aldehyde, then the rate of reaction, the formation of acetal, will get reduced. So the smaller is the chain of the aldehyde, the bigger is the probability of getting acetal formation and then the release of the water molecule. The aromatic aldehydes react more slowly than the aliphatic aldehydes. So these are the few of the important properties. Then the acetaldehyde reacts the quickest and causes the most problems. Because acetaldehyde is the smallest possible carbon chain, it reacts very quickly and creates the water molecule. And hence the acetaldehyde is not suitable, or the KF reagent is not suitable technique to estimate the water content into the acetaldehyde. But there are certain exceptions also. The formaldehyde and chloral do not form acetals and can be titrated without any problems. Okay, so there are certain exceptions too. Now let us understand what is happening with the acetone. So the acetone reacts with the methanol present into the KF reagent and ends up getting the ketal plus water molecules. So what happens with the acetone? And here are the details that with ketones, the reactivity decreases as the chain length increases. It's the same approach. The bigger is the carbon chain of the ketone, the smaller will be the reaction rate. And the ketal formation is most rapid with acetone and cyclohexanone. So these two ketones, acetone and cyclohexanone, has the major impact, and hence the water content in acetone and cyclohexanone may not be evaluated accurately by using KF reagent. So do you understand why the water content of aldehydes and ketones cannot be measured by KF titrator? Now this is the basis for that. But how one can prevent the acetal formation and the ketal formation so that the water molecule will never get released in case of usage of aldehydes and acetone for KF reagent titration? And it's very simple, by using the methanol free KF reagents, because the methanol gets react with the acetone, ketone or the aldehyde. But if there is no methanol present into a reagent, will this reaction happens? It will not. Now, and hence you can use the KF reagent which is free from methanol. So what is the replacement of the methanol? So one can use the 2-methoxyethanol, which is also a suitable alcohol for the KF reagent preparation. So this is how there are now the special KF reagents comes available, which are methanol free and can be used for determination of water contained into ketone and aldehydes. So let us understand what is the third important side reaction, and it is the strong acids. So in case if there is a strong acid present, if your sample is a strong acid, what is going to happen? So the strong acids can react with methanol contained in the KF reagent and release water, right? So let us have the look at the reaction mechanism. And here is the reaction mechanism. Okay, so the strong acids, if you are to measure the water content present in, let us say, sulfuric acid, H2SO4. So sulfuric acid can react with the methanol and further can release the water. The second example can be methanol and with the HOCH that can further release the water molecules. So these are the examples of the strong acids which may not be suitable for determination of water content by using KF reagent. Then the silanols and the siloxanes. So the terminal silanol groups esterify with the methanol contained in the KF reagent and then further release the water molecules. Okay, so this is the reaction mechanism by which the terminal silanol groups, SiOH groups, can react with the methanol present into a KF reagent and then further release the water molecules. The fifth side reaction is about the boron compounds. So the boron compounds like boric acid reacts with methanol with esterification and then release the water molecule. Okay, so this is the reaction mechanism by which the compound containing boron can further release the water molecule because of interaction with the methanol. So you can see very clearly that lots of interaction is happening with the methanol, and because of that the KF reagents looks to be unsuitable. But what is the way forward? Use the methanol free KF reagent and your all problems will be solved then. Then the metal peroxides. So they form water with KF solutions and cannot be titrated directly. The same problem with the metal peroxides. Then reducing agents. So in case if your sample is a strong reducing agent, then the reducing agent can react with the iodine in the KF reagent and simulate a water content that is too high. So this is called as a false positive result. The consumption of iodine is not because of the presence of water molecule, but because of the reducing agent, and you end up measuring the higher water content. And the last but not the least one is strong oxidizing agents. So what happens with the strong oxidizing agents? This release elemental iodine from the iodides in the KF reaction and simulate a water content that is too low. So there is the formation of iodides as a part of a normal KF titration reaction, but the oxidizing reagents further react with the iodides and then the iodides will get back converted into the iodine. And this extra iodine will start further interacting with the water. So there will be a lesser consumption of the iodine, and hence the reagent or the mechanism or the system detects the lower water content. And because of that, you get the false negative result for the water content in case if your sample is the strong oxidizing agent. So these are the various side reactions which is possible in case of KF reagent, and most of the times you have found that methanol is the real culprit, and there is reagents available which are methanol free, and you may avoid the side reaction by using such kind of KF reagents. We also understand, you know, what is the theory and the principle, or the history and the principle of the KF reagents. I hope you must have liked the content of the video, and thank you very much for watching this video till the end. We will meet soon with another kind of interacting and interesting video. Till then, take care and bye-bye. Thank you.